shut it. Those who wanted to be in the house of the Lord but just could not be here today, Lord. We say thank you. We usher the holy praise unto you. Hallelujah, Heavenly Father. We had 10,000 tongues. We could not praise you enough, Lord, for the things that you've done, not just for last night, Heavenly Father, but all through the week you carried us, Heavenly Father. We didn't carry ourselves, Lord. You carried us through, Heavenly Father. But we said, and we say thank you, Lord, for everything you have done, will do. And Lord, we just say hallelujah to your name. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Amen.
Good morning, saints of God. Why don't you give us praise team and have a cup of praise. Today is a good day. A good day to be in the house of the Lord. You ought to just praise and worship him on today. We're now up to our mission and education office. I don't know if we have a special program or not. Put your hand on the violation. If you have a prayer request, put it in the basket. We have a preacher who's going to pray for you on this day. Thank you. us lessons on. And Father, thank you for this opportunity to give back to you a portion that you have given to us. Lord, we pray that these gifts be used for the honor of your kingdom and your glory. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
This is the time when our service crowd, we intercede on behalf of the people. How many of you know that we have a prayer answering God? All you have to do is trust in Him. Whatever you're going through, whatever situation you find yourself in, you just turn it over to Him. And then you move out the way and watch Him work it out. You can either stand where you are, or you can come to God. We have a preacher, Reverend Rick, who's going to lead off the names and the needs of the people. And he's going to take us to the throne.
In my name, he says, I am in the midst. He says, ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto us. And you know, I believe God. And he said, if you ask, believe it, you shall receive. And I just believe that. So I'm asking that you would pray for Miss Joyce. That's the way for help that she has to get better. For Scott, she has the injured hip flexor. For Elizabeth Fernandez, she will have knee surgery in 2 weeks. Linda Sierra fell and broke her five reasons. Mother of Melinda. Johnson family, Keith family, Keith's family, and Dancer family. Prayer for Mary Robert Frazier, Sherry Collins family. Pray for Biggins, Miller, Judge, and Kofi family. Keep those names in your prayers just to pray, not only today, but just during the week. That's about it in prayer. Our Father, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Yahweh, Jehovah, Elohim, El Shaddai, Lord, in the name of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, the Rock, Son of God, Mary's baby, the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, Lord, we come to you. Thank you, Lord, that you woke us up this morning. That you started us on our way, Lord. Thank you, God, for that loving us. We didn't even love ourselves, Lord. The set house that whether two or three were gathered in your name right now, Lord, that you're in the midst of them right now. Right now, Lord, be in the midst of us right now, Lord, as we pray these prayers, Lord. Lord, you know what all of us need, Lord. We come to you, Lord. We come before you, Lord. We come before your holy altar, Lord, begging and pleading, Lord, that you would forgive us for our sins. You said, Lord, in 1 John 1:9, that we confess our sins. You are faithful and you will forgive us of our sins, Father, if we confess our sins, Lord. And then you said in Numbers 23:19 that your word shall not return to your void, Lord. Whatever you say is going to be done, will be done, Lord. Then, Lord, right now, we ask you to bless the overseer of this church, Lord. Bless Pastor Allen G. Madison, Sister Madison, Lord, and their daughter, Carissa, and then the son, Lord, you touch the Father with the Holy Spirit right now. Bless right now all the deacons, Lord, all the trustees. Bless the ushers, bless the choir members, Lord. Bless all the ministers of this church right now, Lord. You know what we have in need of right now, Lord. Let your Holy Spirit right now, Lord, use us to glorify you. For you said now that I be lifted up, that arms will all be lifted to me. Lord, we lift you up right now. We glorify your name this morning, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your blessings, Lord. The seen and unseen blessings, Lord. Lord, help us to be what you would have us to be in these days right now, Lord. And God, when we fall short, Lord, pick us up, Lord. Help us to be what you would have us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. look and fight. And you don't worry. Come on, baby, give it a call. Can you do away? Why don't you wait?
Tamar. Let's give that man Farmer a round of applause. Now let's give God a bigger hand clap. Amen. I'm Bonnie Crowder. I'll be doing your welcome and announcement. This is the time in our service that we would like to acknowledge any visitors. If you are visiting with us, would you please stand and share with us your name and where you are from? Amen. Blessed and strengthened by the love of Jesus, and that you will live a life abundant in fellowship, joy, and liberty. St. Mark Missionary Baptist Church is here for you. It is not just a church, it is a fellowship of believers coming together to declare the glory of the Lord and to celebrate Jesus as King. We are a praying church with a praying pastor. May God richly bless you and keep you, and we hope to see you both again soon. Amen. Galley Breeze Memorial District Association of Baptist Churches, laymen will have their business meeting on Saturday, March the 5th, 2016, from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. at the St. Mark Educational Center. Continental breakfast will be served at 9 a.m. and the meeting will start promptly at 10 a.m. The men's ministry will meet on Monday, March the 7th at 7 p.m. The women's ministry will also meet on Monday, March the 7th at 7 p.m. The Voices of St. Mark Sanctuary Choir will offer food items after worship service in the rear of the church. We want to thank you in advance for your support. If you lost these glasses, please see Sister Betty Tree immediately after church. Let there be unity. The Pastor's Aide would like everyone to get ready for our gratification of service for showing our pastor and wife our sincere appreciation for their years of dedication. It's their 32nd year. Amen. Amen. The theme is unity, a distinctive mark among Christians. The scripture would behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren and to dwell together in unity. And that's coming out of Psalms 133 and 1. The colors are pink and brown, or brown and pink, whichever way you wish to coordinate the colors. The program will be Sunday, March the 20th, during morning worship service. For your convenience, the love offerings, envelopes are available for your donation. Thank you so much for your support, and God be the glory. Sister Sandra Williams, President, Sister Bonnie Crowder, Vice President, and Sister Wanda Jackson, Secretary. Amen. Blessed are the givers, and grateful are the receivers. Thanks so much. We are truly blessed for your donations. May God continue to bless and keep you. We love you. Rose Chapel Missionary Baptist Church, their outreach ministry. Thank you. Sending our big thanks to you for all you do. Words cannot describe how much you are appreciated for your kindness. Pastor Madison, it means so much for our family how much you love and support you. Let me read that again. Pastor Madison, it means so much to our family how much love and support you and all the sisters and brothers have shown us. We really enjoy coming to St. Mark every Sunday. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. It means so much that Pepe was in Blue Alvarado. Thank you. Gratitude
in my attitude. Yeah. I'm going to put gratitude in my attitude. He took away my tears. He took away my pain, took away my fear, and made me smile again. I'm going to put gratitude, filled up with gratitude. I'm going to put gratitude in my attitude. He restored my soul, made me walk instead of crawl, made me new and whole, made me stand tall. I'm going to put gratitude, filled up with gratitude. I'm going to put gratitude in my attitude. He answered the prayers of the humble servant. He's always there when I ask, needs bent. I'm going to put gratitude, filled up with gratitude. I'm going to put gratitude in my attitude. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Before you my sins cowered. You kept my soul free. You kept my soul free. You alone have the power. I'm going to put gratitude in my attitude. Amen. Thank you, St. Mark, and have a blessed week.
Morning, St. Mark.
Morning.
I am losing her. Y'all laughing like you don't believe it. Good morning again. It's so good to see all of you here today. And, how sick of studying this is getting kind of lengthy. And I am really asking St. Mark as a family, let's please pray for those who are sick and shut-in. And I want you all to say a special prayer for my friend, Sergeant. She was stretched on his shoulder. Officer Thornton. He needs your prayers, and I want you today to pray for all of our families and our members who are sick and shut-in. Special prayer for Sister Alfreda, who is going through a trying time right now, along with Brother MacDonald, who is going through times. And let's not forget Sherry Ward, as she goes through Sister Deepa Stevens, Lil Shelby, and also Sister Burns here. Let's not forget her. They need your prayers. You know, you go through some trying times. You want to know that your family, church family, is there. And we don't want to forget those persons who have given so much to St. Mark. And Kathy's mother, we want you to be in prayer for her. And then say that pray for Kathy, who has gone through it. And I can never say enough to Kathy, and she knows it. She has been very faithful. And that means more than anything that you can do. And also, on next Saturday, March the 5th, the Galilee Griggs layman will be meeting at St. Mark's here. And we're asking that our men support that. And is that Rose Chapel next week also? On the 12th. Okay, the planning session of Galilee Griggs District Association will also be here on the 12th of March. And then Rose Chapel will be having that banquet appreciation service for the new pastors that they have called to serve that flock. So let's be in prayer for them also. And to the Alvareta family, we'll see you today. It is a warm and gracious feeling that we have in our hearts for you. And we are so thankful to have you all to worship with us today. I missed all of you last Sunday. I missed you all last Sunday. We do cherish you at the same time we cherish the memories of Tepe. Tepe's always dancing in our hearts around here. And we'll never forget it. And that is God's truth. We'll never forget it. All men will meet immediately after church this morning. Business of importance. Amen? Now, Wednesday nights are special nights around here. You know, education takes place on Wednesday nights. Bible study. Please, you need to know more about your relational fellowship with Jesus Christ. And you need to know some of the things that He has requested of all of us that is our duty and responsibility to the kingdom of God and to one another. Please, a church that prays together, but what that really means, a church that prays together develops a greater fellowship and appreciation for one another in the spirit of Christ. And let's come out and pray for our church, and let's pray for one another, and let's be more informed of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, so that we can break away from the ties that we have with this world, so that we can understand what Christ really did in our behalf, that we can be more thankful and grateful for. We have a reason to praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, you know, I like to really deal with all this election stuff, but you really need to really understand what's happening in the world of politics. When you stop and think about it, when you look at the persons who are running for the office of president, does that office really deserve clowns like you see? I have never felt so embarrassed as a citizen of this country to think about how those who are outside of this country look into this country and ask the question, do you mean these are the people who try to tell us how to live and govern when they've got nothing but circus clowns running for president? That is a disgrace. It is a disgrace. And to see people of faith, people of faith who uphold this kind of behavior, and people who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, who will associate with this kind of mess, is a disgrace to the kingdom of God. Everyone doing? My name is Brother Gasson, and I'll be introducing this year's Black Heritage Month production. Can't do this in front of this man up here. Forgive me. Madison, I blame you. But again, we're getting ready for the... We're getting ready for the production. If you will, just for a moment, think about
what Black Heritage Month truly means. All of those who have paved the way for us, who have went through unimaginable circumstances and trials to pave a better way for us. And by the way that we act today, sometimes it shows our unappreciation for what they've done for us. It's a circumstance that at times is saddening, that you think about all of the things that they went through in the civil rights, slavery, segregation, and we act like that it was very minuscule by the way that we act and carry ourselves today. So with this production, what we want to do is share with you some of the circumstances that some of those who paved the way and came before us went through, so that we can have a better day and hope that it will enlighten us on today to be a better people. I give to you, I've been through the storm. Thank you.
Thank you.
And you know, what I really want to know is during slavery, you know, the times of segregation, how was that for you?
Well, Oprah, you know, we were separated from Lee's family.
Yeah.
You know, fathers and sons, they would come, they was beaten.
You don't say.
And they was killed.
Yeah.
Mothers and daughters, they were raped.
So hold on, Harriet. So you're saying that fathers and sons were killed and hung, and mothers and daughters were raped?
Yes.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Carry on, Harriet. So let me pause you for a second, Harriet. Ma'am, you look like a very righteous kind of woman. You know. So let's say you were in Harriet's shoes. Well, black for us. Would you say that you would be able to handle having seen your kinfolk, your father and your sons killed, and your daughter and your mother, right? Could you handle that, young lady?
No, ma'am.
And why is that?
Because I was in the retaliation. I got the right to
bear arms. So you would have been good for Harriet Tubman, but she's always had. So Harriet, go ahead and finish your story. So you were at mothers and daughters being raped.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mothers and daughters was raped. Oprah, I wish that on no one.
Uh-huh.
No one, Oprah. It was too much to bear.
Yeah. Gosh, I feel that. Amazing. The strength and the courage that you had. Amazing. So Harriet, we all know that those were terrible circumstances that you were faced with. Can you enlighten us with just a little bit more of what you've gone through during this segregated and slavery time?
Yes. I was about 7 years old.
Uh-huh.
When they sent me away from the people.
Uh-huh. Discovered the Underground Railroad for our slaves.
So that was the freedom
So I must ask you, is this one of your slaves that was through the Underground Railroad? Can you confirm this? Yeah. Only on the Oprah Winfrey Show, folks. You see an Underground Railroad, a true live slave on the Oprah Winfrey Show, but this is the Underground Railroad. Sir, what is your name?
William Washington,
there you have it, folks. All right, Harry, carry on. A real live slave, only on the Oprah Winfrey Show.
Uh-huh. I said, oh freedom,
yes.
Oh freedom, yes. Oh freedom over me. As before, I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave.
Yes, yes.
And go on home to be with my Lord.
Yeah.
Oh yes, oh yes.
Well, there you have it, folks. Let's give it up for Harriet Tubman. Yes, give it up for Harriet Tubman, a truly remarkable woman. Remarkable indeed, been through the storm. So we have a true pioneer here that most of you may not have heard of, and his name is Green Black. Hello, how are you doing, Mr. Green? So, Mr. Green, I'm sorry, Clay. Many of us don't know who you really are. Can you possibly expound on what was your take in Black heritage?
Yeah, I can.
Okay, go ahead.
I was part of the first Black pioneers. And we settled in Utah land.
Yeah.
I was baptized at age 16 in the Great Latter-day Saints. They gave it to me to the church at the time.
Yeah.
I was really one of the great missionaries for Black enslavement. The Black
Latter-day Saints. Oh, how funny being a slave and keeping with that.
Well, I reckon slavery's all right, if you want to be a slave, that is. Most of us colored folks, we want a better life.
Yeah.
You see, I was raised as a slave. Uh-huh. Had a master. You worked hard. Mm. Gave me food to eat, place to sleep, clothes on my back. Sometimes he whipped me.
Wow.
And sometimes getting a stiff kick in the rib in the pants if I just stiffen up to him.
So, Mr. Flake, I'm sure that didn't feel good at all.
Go ahead.
So, by him getting a stiff kick in the pants, how did you endure that? My goodness, that must have been really hard to take. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Carry on, Mr. Flake. I can't imagine.
Slavery been around a long time.
Uh-huh.
We were traded, we were bought, we were sold, wow. Like animals, wow. Like horses and cows. We were the property of the owner. Nobody wants to live like that, bound to another person. You don't have no rights, you don't have no dignity, you don't have no dreams, you don't have no love,
wow. Nothing. Wow, that kind of wipes everything out there.
Yes,
so,
yes.
So how did you continue on?
God,
yes.
Hope and faith in God is God.
Yeah.
You see, Uncle?
Yeah, get up for him, yeah. Thank you, God. Absolutely. Absolutely.
My favorite scripture was, in my father's house there are many mansions. Mm-hmm. You see, we worked hard.
Yeah.
And see, we worked real hard for the master.
Yeah.
Mm. And see, a lot of slaves are sold to death. Dying was the only way they know they could be free of. Some slaves would die just to get out of their misery.
Wow. Amazing. I could not fathom the thought of wanting to meet death instead of working to be slaves. Wow, it's just blowing my mind right now, I'm telling you. You know, your strength, I just couldn't imagine living in those harsh times, but your strength and faith carried you through and into a better way of life. I couldn't imagine that. I could not imagine that. So, Mr. Flake, would you say that the only thing that gave you strength was Christ and knowing you were going to be free one day?
Yes, sir. You know, when a person takes away your present, you don't have no future. You're like a walking dead.
Yeah.
And the only thing we had faith, we knew we had, living in Christ, one day we'd be free. Free at last, free at last.
Yeah, that's so much for Flake. Well, I want to thank you, Mr. Flake, for sharing your story. Those of you, those of us who didn't know who he was, now know that his name was Greenflake. He took his place in Black heritage. So I've noticed the mother of civil rights has been very shy and quiet, Ms. Rosa Parks. How are ya? Awesome, awesome. So how are you doing, Rosa? What was it like being the mother of the civil rights movement that led to what we know today as the first civil rights movement? How are you feeling? How are you feeling? Tell us.
Well, I'm feeling fine, Oprah. You know, being buses. Just having to be in this seat.
Yeah. Well, I tell you, I got that seat just for you to take a rest off of. So you don't have to worry about getting up anytime soon. So tell us about the day that we will never forget that is etched in our Black heritage.
Well, Oprah, I remember it on December 1st, 1955.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the most memorable and inspiring days of my life. Oprah, history records that day as the beginning of the modern civil rights movement.
Yeah, yeah.
And it transformed America, and it influenced several freedom revolutions around the world.
Wow. So let me pause you there, Rosa. Let me ask one of my guests, if you were in Rosa's time and you had just gotten on the bus and you were tired, would you have done the same thing, young lady?
Yes, I would have. I have bad feet myself.
So you have bad feet in form too? Well, that'll get you every time, won't it? So I know I'm ready to sit down right now. So you would do the same thing and spark a new movement?
Yes, I would.
Thank you so much. Carry on, Rosa.
Well, you know, Oprah, 4 days before that, I had just been arrested for not giving up my seat to a white man on the bus, which is a much, you know, extended practice at that time.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So, it was not a good time.
Wow.
It was not a good time.
Wow.
But I believe Martin Luther King said to me and others, when history books are written in the future, there will be a black people of fleecy locks, black complexion, a people that had the moral courage to stand up for their rights. And I just
and I know he can vouch because he's sitting here.
Yes. And we just believe that we need to stand up for our rights, and enough was enough. And these people would go on to change the world, to inject in the veins of history a new meaning.
New meaning.
For our history and for just civilization.
Yeah.
You remember when you said that, Mark?
Yes, Ms. Parks, how are you?
So, Mrs. Parks, something truly changed indeed. Carry on. I remember there was an instance when you phoned your mom from the jail cell.
I phoned my mom from the jail cell that first night they gave me the call. And the first thing my mother asked me was, baby, did they beat you?
Wow. So Rosa, what you're saying is when you called your mom, she thought they had whipped you and beat you in that jail cell.
She thought they had whipped me and beat me.
Wow.
I tell you, I've been through this.
You can only imagine. Imagine.
Wow, Rosa, that must have been really tough. That must have been really tough, Rosa.
I tell you, Oprah, I've been through the storm.
Well, Mrs. Parks, I'm truly glad that you have shared your story with us today. Let's give it up for our audience. Ms. Rosa Parks, thank you so much. And I know someone on that panel is sitting right next to you, Dr. Martin Luther King, that can express why he's here as well. Hi, Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. Hi, are you?
I'm well, Oprah.
Awesome. So, Dr. King, where do I begin with you? Where did it all start? Can you help us realize our birth and our dreams and how you made that possible for us? Elaborate, Dr. King, will you?
Well, you know, I answered a call and that was much bigger than myself.
Yeah.
I answered a calling that was much bigger than I could ever imagine.
Wow, Dr. King. Wow, so you truly answered a calling. So what was it like, you know, being many people against you and all? What was that like? Can you elaborate on that for us?
Well, Oprah, it was a lot of people against me.
Yeah, lots.
But Oprah, it was also a lot of people for me.
Yeah.
With God for you, Oprah, who can be against you?
I totally agree.
See, I realized back then, Oprah, that it just wasn't about me.
Yeah.
And you have to realize when you have faith that sometimes God uses you to touch other people, to get them to do what they need to do.
That's right.
See, I was young, Oprah, and I realized that it was something special about myself and my life.
Yeah, well, how young were you, Dr. King?
I was only 26, Oprah. I was 26 years old when Mrs. Park decided not to give up her seat.
Wow.
That's when I started the bus boycott.
Wow.
It lasted 381 days.
Wow, that's a long time.
And that was a monomania movement that started this year called my dream.
So let me pause you right there, Dr. King, and come over to this young lad. So I see that you are 26 years old. What's your name?
I agree.
So being 26 in this day and age, could you see yourself leading marches such as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.?
No.
And why would that be, sir?
I like the maturity to do anything like that. You see the text?
In the middle of my open show. You got your camera, you know. So you should have been able to lead marches like Dr. Martin Luther King in 26.
No, I just like the maturity. I'm concerned about other things. I think that's pretty noble. I'm not there.
He's not there yet, folks. You heard it right here. He's not quite there yet. So, Dr. King, you've led many marches and have done many speeches, and you've moved mountains. What would you say your inspiration was?
Well, where it wasn't a time I gave a speech, I wasn't nervous. It wasn't a time, Oprah, that I led a march. It wasn't fear.
Yeah.
But it was God that helped me through it all. See, courage is only fear that's craving.
Yes.
And when you have that kind of hope and faith to your journey, you can march on. See, I realized, Oprah, that sometimes I got tired.
Yes.
Mentally, Oprah, and physically. But you never know the extremities that the mind and the body can overcome until you face the extreme circumstances.
So, Dr. King, in your statement there, you said that you got tired and weary, would you say? So that was very intuitive, by the way. You know, you kept going on because of your strength and the cause. That was a very intuitive gesture, Dr. King. So what inspires you to continue to go?
Every day I got up, and I realized that if I kept marching, Oprah, one day we'd all be free.
Yeah.
I realized, Oprah, that one day we all would see better days.
Yeah.
And I realized, Oprah, that if I turn back the same situation that I was in, many of those that come after me would face the same thing. And that would have been very selfish of me, Oprah. So I continue. I prayed some more. And that kept my mind thinking. It kept my feet moving. It kept my heart pumping, moving on towards the promised land. See, Oprah, I've been stoned, been spit upon, been cursed, been jailed, stabbed, Oprah, within an inch of my life.
Hold on a second, because I know there's some people in this audience that wouldn't be able to be stoned. They'd pick the stone up and throw it right back. Am I correct, audience? Yeah. You look like a guy that would pick the stone up and you would have threw it back, correct? You would have got a bigger knife, correct?
Right.
So he would have been doing some stabbing back. So I can only imagine you there bleeding and stones being thrown at you, that you would still stand in peace and preach nonviolence. I just couldn't imagine. Wow. Unbelievable.
See, Oprah, it was at the end of the day, it was love, Oprah. Love that carried me through it all. That continued to bring me peace.
Yeah.
In the midst of my storms. And it's gonna be love, Oprah, that eventually that will carry us on.
I'm touched and I'm speechless right now. Wow. Well, we definitely want to thank our panel. Let's give it up for our panel here today. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Mrs. Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, and Grady Blake. They've been through the storm. Thank you guys so much. They've been through the storm. Freedom. Freedom. It came, but it was not easy. It came with blood, sweat, and tears. It cost the nation the Civil War to free its slaves. Many of our race fought in the war. And after it was over, we were finally emancipated. But we had new challenges that faced us. We call ourselves African American because we cherish our heritage. It gave us some sort of completeness. African and American. We were here, and we're still here, building our lives and carving out our legacies. Let us not ever lose sight of those who paved the way before us. Let us not ever lose sight to begin to pave the way for our generations to come. Let us know that we have just as much right to a better life, just as our other races. So let's lift our heads high, and let's walk proud, and let's speak proud. We as a people have overcome storms in every fashion. So I tell you today, folks, let your light so shine before men. And we want to take this time to say thank you to our panel, and we thank you to our audience as well. You'll notice on the Oprah Winfrey Show, we give away gifts. Everyone gets a gift today. If you look in your pews, there will be some tithing papers and offering cards. Everyone gets one. We just ask that you put a little something in it and turn it back in. So we want you all to please join us next week for our show with me on the greatest funeral home this side of heaven. The Evergreen Funeral Home. And our panel with me, Pastor Alan Jean Madison, and our theme is going to be How to Lay It to Rest. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh.
along the way, and to bring you to the place I have prepared. Pay attention to him and listen to what he says. Do not rebel against him. He will not forgive your rebellion, since my name is in him. If you listen carefully to what he says and do all that I say, I will be an enemy to your enemies and will oppose those who oppose you. My angel will go ahead of you and bring you into the land of the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And I will wipe them out. Do not bow down before their gods or worship them or follow their practices. You must demolish them and break their sacred stones to pieces. Worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be on your food and water. I will take away sickness from among you, and none will miscarry or be barren in your land. I will give you a full lifespan. I will send my terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. I will make all your enemies turn their backs and run. I will send the hornet ahead of you to drive the Hivites, the Canaanites, and the Hittites out of your way. But I will not drive them out in a single year, because the land will become desolate and the wild animals too numerous for you. Little by little, I will drive them out before you until you have increased enough to take possession of the land. I will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Sea of the Palestine, and from the desert to the river. I will hand over to you the people who live in the land, and you will drive them out before you. Do not make a covenant with them or with their gods. Do not let them live in your land, or they will cause you to sin against me, because the worship of their gods will certainly be a snare to you. May the Lord have blessed to the reading, hearing, and expression of doing of his word. I want to talk for a few minutes about God is not slow. God is not slow. Brother Jerry, a story was told about a young boy. He found the cocoon outside one day, and while playing, he took it inside where his mother and father instructed him what it was. He was told how there was life inside, one that at one time had been an ugly caterpillar. It was now being transformed into a beautiful butterfly. The boy was fascinated and could hardly wait for the day when it would emerge. Finally, the day came. He noticed a movement in the cocoon and noticed that a small hole was beginning to show in one end. He watched with anticipation as the young butterfly tried to emerge. For so long, the struggle seemed to go on without any progress. The boy became impatient and decided to help the butterfly. He got a pair of scissors and cut open a large hole, making it possible for the new butterfly to emerge quickly and easily. It was quite a sight, but colorful, although quite wrinkled. The boy watched and watched, waiting to see this new life take flight and fly away to fulfill the purpose it was created for. However, with great disappointment, he waited, for nothing happened. The new butterfly did not fly. Instead, it slowly withered and died. In talking to someone who knew much about butterflies, he discovered what had gone wrong. In order for the butterfly to fly after emerging, they must have had to struggle through a tiny hole in order to force the liquids into the wings to make the wings fill out. The boy's effort at speeding up this process by cutting the hole larger had caused this stage to be aborted, thus effectively ending the possibility that it would ever be able to fly and fulfill its created purpose. The desire to speed up the butterfly deliverance only consigned it to certain death. Instead of helping it, he destroys. You know, God often does this with us also. He does not always deliver us quickly because he knows that the process of struggling is healthy for us. It builds character. While we would like to have an easy and quick solution to our problem, this may not in the long run always be good for us. The Bible teaches us that God only moves as fast in our lives as we are able to keep up. And that is in keeping with his plan for us. God is not slow. He is doing a work of grace to prepare us for larger responsibilities and his will in our life. We need to trust the process. Look at somebody next to you and say, trust the process. In verses 20 through 26, we see a divine deal. Here in verse 20, God offers to make contact with them. God says he will send them an angel. Angels are God's created messengers. This messenger will represent God to them. God was in the angel the same way he was present in the pillar of cloud and fire. God has always desired contact with his people. They would not have to walk alone. God would go before them and be with them. God never asked us to go anywhere. Brother Turner, he asked us to go anywhere without him. They were thus assured of victory. God never loses, and since they were going with him, they couldn't eat. Being with their shepherd and knowing his voice and leading would be all that they would need. Staying in contact with our shepherd is important. He is the one who leads us, guides us, and instructs us. In verse 21 and 26, God gives instruction to this divine deed. They were to obey the angel of the Lord. They were not to rebel against him. Obedience would play an important role in their success. The instructions call for them to completely avoid practices and ideals of false religion and false gods. God would ensure their success only as long as they followed his commands. This is still true. Those most successful in God's kingdom are obedient servants. God will not destroy the enemy without their help. They will be a part of the process. But with his strength and help, they won't be able to lose. The quality of their future rested on what they did in the present. See, our future glory is being shaped right now. In verse 27 through 33, we see a divine deliverance. God here promises to put a fear on their enemies if they will walk with him. Their enemies would be terrified of Israel, knowing that God fights for them and with them. Their enemy would know of God's love and blessings on Israel, and this would put fear in their hearts. This would really build Israel's confidence. They would walk with their heads held high. Great confidence would enable them to be victorious. Yeah. They will not be afraid of the future or success.
There you go.
But success will not come all at once.
Right.
It would come step by step.
There you go,
right. Here in verse 29 and 30 is the key part of this passage. Mm. It says God will not drive their enemies out all at once in a short period of time. God will go slowly with the victory. Not because he delights in making them miserable, but for practical reason. To let them drive out all their enemies at once successfully would have left them with more victories than they could handle. Quick and full victory would have left a lot of open land and empty cities that they were not strong enough to take possession of. They were not numerous enough to, or strong enough to handle all the new enemies. wild animals and weeds would take over. Then they would have had to fight a second time. God was saving them the grief later by going slowly now. This slow process would encourage their skill for future larger tasks. Brother Griffin, when American Airlines trains their pilots, they first seek to prove them by use of a simulator. This simulator is designed to present the pilot with a variety of potential problems so that he will be able to handle any emergency in the future under real conditions. He learns on a simpler level with smaller events, eventually building up to complicated events, and then on to find a real plan. Aren't you glad that they learn on a smaller scale first? How would you like to be 30,000 feet in the air with a pilot in training? This is similar to how God works in our lives. He gives us victory over small things first, and then builds from that. If we can't handle the smaller things, he doesn't destroy us with larger things. Some people want quick, easy victories. They want the shortcuts. If they take them, they will miss out on becoming all they could be. God did not want to solve one of their problems by creating a new one. He knew that victory would be better for them in a longer time frame. God lists several reasons for giving victories over a span of time here in our text. Number one, God says partial victories would give them time to grow strong. Number two, partial victories now would give them time to adjust to a new environment. Thirdly, it would prevent wild animals from multiplying and creating a new problem down the road. It would allow a new generation of Israelites who have never fought before to learn how to fight and develop their skills. It would also keep them dependent on God over a longer period of time, thus keeping them from developing self-sufficiency. It would keep them from having more than they could have. God still works this way with us for often the same reason. He doesn't want to overwhelm us with more than we are strong enough to handle. In verses 32 and 33, God calls for commitment. While God reiterates his action, he again made clear to them that he is calling for a commitment on their part. They are not to water down their commitment to him by compromising with those they are to drive out. God implores them to make a covenant, not to make a covenant with the enemy, only with him. God warns them that if they compromise, the pagans will be a snare to them. In the Hebrew, this term snare is stronger than the English term would suggest. It means destruction, not just stumbling. God wanted them strong and safe and victorious in the long run. Victory would not be quick and easy. They couldn't handle that, though they would have preferred it that way, no doubt. Trust him with the process. He is not slow, only we are. Why is it that God seems to move so slowly, so often in answering our prayers? God's purpose in our lives is not too much to move conflict as it is to build our character and to teach us faith. Victory over time keeps us relying on God and gives us the time to mature so that we can handle the victories that come without producing sinful pride. God moves slowly so we can keep up with him. He will rarely move faster than the rate at which we are willing to follow him or able to follow him. God warns the Israelites that they are to cling to him if they are to weather the storm and succeed. Have you ever seen a big tree with a vine growing around? You know, vines are interesting things. They have no real strength in themselves. They are easily destroyed by winds of adversity and storm. The only thing that makes them a success is when they have learned to cling to something stronger than themselves. By growing on a strong tree and curling around and around it, they are immune to almost from damage. If contrary winds blow against them, they are simply blown tighter against the tree. If winds come from the other direction, they are protected from harm by the tree itself blocking them. No matter what direction the storm comes from, they are held in place. They can spend their time growing because they rely on the trees for strength. That is the way it should be with us when the storms are raging in our life. We should cling to God. It doesn't matter what direction the storms come from. They can come from the east or the west. They can come from the north. You just cling to God. It doesn't matter how big the storm. It can be a category 15 hurricane. It can come in the form of a disease. You just cling to God. Am I right about it? See, it doesn't matter what form it comes in. It can come in the form of an illness. It can come in the form of a disease. It can come in the form of a lost job, a broken relationship. Whatever the form, you just cling to God and He will protect you. And He will sustain you. And He will heal you. You just hold on, hold on, hold on to God's unchanging hand. Don't let go of God's hand. For with God, all things are possible. If you need a healing, hold on to God. If you need deliverance, you just hold on to God unchanging hand. And He will lead you, and He will guide you, and He will instruct you. God is not slow, only we are. We must learn to wait on God, and the living will come. Won't you give a love? Though the storms of life is raging in my life, Lord, the church is open.
Amen.
Time can't tell the day from night, but that hope that lies within is reassuring. As I keep eyes upon the distant shore, I know He'll lead me safely to that blessed place. But if the storm don't cease, and if the wind keeps blowing in my life, my soul surrender in the Lord. From now, but the hope that lies within is real, As I keep my eyes upon the distant shore, I know you'll leave me safe to that place.
Prayer, and Sister Sheila Williams is coming down for rededication. Proceed. Oh, wow. Sisters. Amen.
Good morning, Chris family. I just want to say that I feel like I'm 50 years old. I'm still not where the Lord wants me to be. So today, I want to dedicate my life back to the Lord. Amen. Amen.
You feel like you've been.
Yeah, I am.
You know, I'll tell you something. That's a good thing. Because it lets you know that the Lord is bidding you to come a little closer to Him. And not one of us are where we ought to be in the Lord. But because of His grace and His mercy, God gives us another day to seek Him and to draw closer to Him. And the scripture teaches us, if we draw nigh to Him, He'll draw nigh to us. So that's the attractiveness of the love of God that is bidding you to come to a closer relationship with Him. And that's a good feeling to have. And that's a good place to be. And you have these two little ones here. God has something for you to do. And you can get your relationship closer by getting in the Word of God and studying that Word and allowing the Holy Spirit to bring you into the fellowship of other brothers and sisters and get in that Wednesday night Bible class if you can. It'll help you greatly. And you know, you're still a member here. Now you want to come back in the right standing. God bless you, Gary. All right, my brother and my sister, they're coming from France. Won't you join us? Eternal God, our Father, we come now into my presence. We know you're here, Lord, because you're everywhere all at the same time. And there's not a time that you have not been with us. And because we have received you as our Savior, because we received you as our Lord, you proved in your word that you abided in us and we in you. And
And since you're here right now, we're going to touch and agree right now that whatever it is that is concerning the two of these, our brother and sister, we know that you're in the midst of it. But we ask that through your word and through a closer fellowship with you, that you would bring forth that which is bringing them to the point of seeking you in prayer. So we touch and agree right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we say it is so. In Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Amen. All right. All right. Somebody said, Pastor, when are we going to hear you preach? It just happened to fall on us. But next Sunday, the Lord says the same. I want you to go home and I want you to read and study the fifth chapter of 1 John. And we're going to be talking from the fifth chapter of 1 John. And we want to know, how is your confidence in the one who you claim to believe in? And that's Jesus Christ. We're going to have a good time. So I want you to come and I want you to be read at it. I want you to be studied at it. And then that'll make preaching very easy, because you will be in tune with the Spirit of God. Amen? Amen. And I think that, where's Oprah? You did a great job, Oprah. You really made me understand and feel that Oprah is kind of stupid. Now, what do I mean by that? It's the questions and the comments that Oprah makes behind each one of us. You did a great job. And to those of you who were here, you did a great job. And where is Brother Blake? Oh, but you know what? I want you to go back. I want you to really read the history of Brother Flakes in the Mormon church. And you'll discover something that you won't believe. They allowed them to be there, but they really thought that they were devils. And the black in the Mormon church could never reach the celestial scope. You have to read the level of their beliefs. And today, the Mormon church is one of the largest churches in the country. They believe it or not, they do some good things. But they believe that Jesus and Satan are brothers, and that Jesus is not the Messiah. So you have to be careful what you believe in, and you have to be careful what you accept as truth. You know, and I say this among my brothers and sisters, Pepe's family, you and the Negro have gone through some struggles in life. But you know what? If you stop and think about it, from the Hispanic side and from the Negro side, I always say Negro, we have come a long way. We have been blessed beyond measure. And the thing of it is, if we would unite together, not as a group of people, but as one race of people, because when you read Acts chapter 17, and you go down to Acts chapter 17 and you read right around verse 24, you will understand what Paul was saying when he was at Mars Hill, when he found people worshiping other gods. And it was that one unknown God
that they had that they knew nothing about. That's the God that Paul got up and talked about. And Paul says he has made one race of people to dwell together on the face of the earth. If we all, regardless, could come to the understanding that we are one race and that we all have something in common, this world would be a better place to live in, and the greed of money would not separate us, because we would have all things in common. But Satan doesn't want that. He wants us to look at each other as being different, and we're really not. We're one people. Amen? Amen. Now, the question is today, if you wanted to prove your love for God, that's one way you can do that. Take out your checkbook and your credit card account. See how much you have spent on yourself and the world compared to what you've given God. What would your answer be? Do you love God? Or do you love the things of the world? What would your bank, your checking account say, and what would your credit card say, based upon the fact of where you have placed your interest and your concern? Would it be on the kingdom of God, or would it be in the kingdom of the world? So the question is, will a man rob God? Yes, indeed. But today, you can repent from being an embezzler and a robber, and give God what is just and due. Amen? They want to put you on a guilt trip, but I really wanted you to see yourself and how you treat God and the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. We want to have some blessed quietness. Do y'all know what that is? No change. All right, Ursus, come on. And another thing, let some of those 20s and 50s come to church rather than just dollars, okay? Come on. That is my man. All right. Ursus. Thank you. Lord and our God, we thank you for these gifts that have been given today. We praise your name, Lord. In Jesus, amen. For those of you who are visiting with us here today, we thank and praise God, our Heavenly Father, for your presence. And we ask you, always feel free to visit with us here at St. Mark. Great things are happening here at St. Mark. You just got to be here to see. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let us not forget our sick and our shut-in today. Let's be in prayer for them. They need your prayers. You never know when your time will come. And when that time comes, and nobody calls and visits you, just remember, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You reap what you sow. Amen? So don't get mad at nobody and say, well, I've been there all this time and nobody has called me. Just remember, you reap what you sow. Amen. Somebody called me? I heard my name. That's I don't want to hear that. But anyway, it's been a good day. Thank you, Brother Range, for the message today. Also, Brother Dickerson, I think your brother has an appointment coming up, right? Yeah, we hope and pray everything's all right. I thought I saw Sister Dickerson hand waving. The choir is, what proof is that?
What proof?
All right, let us support the choir. We don't say selling, we have donations. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Let's help our choir, let's participate. Let the church say, Sister Washington, Sister Mary. All right. Everybody. Wherever we go in leaving this place, Allow us through your spirit to let our light shine, that others will know that we're your children, and that the influence that we have of that saltiness will influence others to want to know you as I walk daily among those that don't know you. Keep us mindful of the fact that we're kingdom kids and that you're our Father. And now may the love, the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of us henceforth, now and forevermore. Men are asked to meet after church. Don't forget to go over in the educational building and support the choir.